when we replace estrogen in the vagina, we have growth of healthy lactobacilli strains, and that can help with repopulation of healthy bacteria in the urethra and the bladder as well.
Any research at the moment around what different types of antibiotic treatment do to the urinary microbiome? So short courses of antibiotics or prophylactic doses versus long-term full dose antibiotics?
That's a great question. I think there are some, there's early research into that. I think we certainly suspect that antibiotic exposure does alter the urinary microbiome, and it does make women more prone to getting another infection by reducing the amount of protective bacteria. But I think there are no conclusive studies that I know of right now, but certainly that is a big question that everyone's asking. And I think it makes sense that antibiotic exposure does alter the urinary microbiome, because you get certain populations of bacteria, like, let's say, I think we were talking about this, you can have E. coli, which is sensitive to cephalosporins, and you might have a little bit of enterococcus, which is sitting around doing absolutely nothing. Now you've taken cephalosporins to get rid of the E. coli, and suddenly the enterococcus has no competitor for nutrients or space, and that enterococcus is going to flourish. So I think, number one, you can get overgrowth of competing pathogens, and then you can get a decrease in the population of protective bacteria. So I think that, we're going to start seeing that as we further characterize what the microbiome looks like in antibiotic treated patients. And it is definitely an area of interest.
Okay. And so you deplete the existing microbiome, and what is left behind after the treatment? Do you think that has some more antibiotic resistance given the treatment that you've just been through?
Yeah, it's certainly possible that the bacteria, which are not aimed to be treated, start developing resistance to whatever antibiotic they become exposed to.
Mm-hmm. And is that a long-term issue, or is that something that kind of just changes over time?
Well, it depends. I think to an extent it is a long-term issue, because, bacteria, when they get exposed to an antibiotic, they can develop resistance very quickly. And, one example is we see these strains of what are called ESBL, or extended spectrum beta-lactamase bacteria, and they develop resistance to most antibiotics. Orally, you can treat it with nitrofurantoin or Bactrim, but if it's not sensitive, then the patients are really, their only option at that point is a really big gun antibiotic like imipenem or carbapenem. Usually patients who are developing those ESBL infections have had exposure to other antibiotics prior.
Okay. Do you think there is any way that we can help replenish the urinary microbiome after treatment?
So that's a great question. And I think that there is a role for both estrogen and probiotics. One of the most important bacteria that we have in the vagina and also in the bladder is lactobacillus. When we take oral probiotics, there are some studies to show that the lactobacillus actually does populate in the vagina. We have a vaginal probiotic on the market now, which has good strains of lactobacillus, like lactobacillus crispatus. Mm-hmm. which, you know, you can use directly in the vagina. And when you have those strains of lactobacillus in the vagina, you know, it's from there that they can repopulate inside the bladder. The other important aspect of that is estrogen. When we replace estrogen in the vagina, we have growth of healthy lactobacilli strains. And again, that can help with repopulation of healthy bacteria in the urethra and the bladder as well.
Okay, that's good to know. When it comes to urinary antiseptics like Hiprex, do they have the same problem of depleting the healthy microbiome and causing antibiotic resistance?
I don't know of, it's a great question. I don't know of any study where they've looked at the variety of bacteria in the bladder before and after Hiprex. Mm-hmm. You know, Hiprex works by basically converting, it makes ammonia and formaldehyde in the bladder. And so I think if you have, you know, if you have a large amount of bacteria, or you have a bacteria which is trying to cause an infection in the bladder, the Hiprex is essentially working to prevent it from being able to replicate, because the formaldehyde is bacteriostatic. Mm-hmm. And so, so unless the bacteria is attempting to be like metabolically active, then I don't know that having Hiprex is going to make a difference. The other thing is that Hiprex works only when the urine is acidic. Mm-hmm. And I think a lot of people who take it, you know, they're not monitoring their urine pH. So if the urine pH is 6 or above, it's not really doing anything. So mm-hmm. It's really important that, you know, that's why we use it with vitamin C. And if a person is taking, let's say, 1 gram of vitamin C a day, then we increase it and their urine is not acidic, then we increase it, because otherwise the Hiprex is not doing anything.
Okay. And talking about non-antibiotic approaches, there have been some studies that have indicated that ibuprofen could be an appropriate alternative to taking antibiotics for an acute UTI. Do you think that's an actual problem and could lead to increased recurrence rates? Or is it safe for some patients to try that?
I think that there are a large number of women who get UTIs and their immune systems are incredibly efficient mm-hmm. at clearing them. And there was recently a really fascinating talk, by Dr. Abraham, who's a professor at Duke, where it was on the UTI Global Alliance. And, you know, he went into the way in which the immune system in the bladder clears infection. Mm-hmm. And the first response is to get rid of bacteria. And the second response is then to repair the damaged tissue. And so I think you're going to get women where their immune system gets in very quickly and is very efficient at clearing the bacteria. And so when they take ibuprofen for the symptoms and let their immune system do the rest, it works. I think that there are other women in whom you are going to allow that bacteria to hang around for a longer period of time. Mm-hmm. And that's where you may start getting these, you know, intracellular reservoirs. You know, he was showing that if the immune system's response is to switch from bacterial clearance to tissue repair too quickly, mm-hmm. you actually get bacteria embedded in the lamina propria, you know, which is a deeper layer of the mucosa in the bladder, because the tissue starts to repair before the bacteria is fully cleared. And there you get like truly, you know, what we would consider an embedded situation. So, I mean, I think for myself and my patients, if you have a UTI, I favor treating it, mm-hmm. You know, because I think that if we're just relying on your immune system to clear it, we're rolling the dice.
It sounds like your body might actually help it become worse in that case, if that mechanism occurs.
If it occurs that way, you may be favoring mm-hmm. the bacteria embedding into a deeper layer of the bladder tissue. Yes.
Do you think for a lot of people that do experience recurrent UTI that it is actually an embedded UTI, where the symptoms just flare intermittently over time?
Yeah, I do. I think that there is definitely a population of women where the bacteria has formed a quiescent reservoir in the bladder, and it reemerges from time to time. I think when that happens, we have actually been able to prove on culture, that it's the same bacteria that's coming back. You have to be very careful because there are a lot of women who have symptoms from genitourinary syndrome of menopause, and that can really mimic the symptoms of a urinary tract infection, where it's that burning, that irritation, the increased frequency, the pressure. And so you really have to pay attention to whether it's something that's like waxing and waning. Like, I kind of, yeah, I was noticing I had to urinate more. I had this increased awareness of my bladder and urethra. And then as the day went on, I sort of drank more water, and then, the feeling sort of went away versus, it progressed. I was running to the bathroom every 5 minutes. The pain was so bad that, I was taking Advil and Tylenol and Peridium. And so you really have to be in tune to whether it's waxing and waning and it kind of just goes away, versus whether when it comes on, it actually progresses to full-fledged symptoms.